Okay, kid, listen. I'm coming in, okay?
No! Don't!
Exactly what the hell is the situation? What, did you shit yourself or something?
Oh, I wish. I got it stuck.
You got what stuck?
It!
Oh! It, well, listen, it's not the end of the world. These kind of things happen. Let's have a look at it.
No, for God's name, say it!
Shh! Shh!
Sheila!
No!
Sheila, honey?
Don't!
Sheila, honey, you gotta come here. You gotta see this.
What? No! Don't
come in here, honey.
Don't!
Don't worry. She's a dental hygienist. She'll know exactly what to do.
Hi, Ted.
Hi, Mrs. Jensen. How are you?
You okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Holy shit!
Shh.
Charlie could have warned me.
Keep it down.
Okay,
Charlie,
yeah,
Mrs. Jensen. I just don't want Mary to...
Okay.
I don't want her here, you know?
Okay. Let's just relax here, okay? Now, what exactly are we looking at here?
What do you mean? What?
Well, I mean, is it the, or the...
Is it the Frank or the beans?
Right.
I don't know. It looks like, I think it's a little bit of both.
Break them beans!
Shh.
Break them beans!
Oh, shh.
So, I heard you guys slept with the big D.
Excuse me?
Divorce. It's rough. I've been there. I've actually had three big Ds slap me right across the face.
You have to know you're saying that wrong.
The first month is the hardest. You reevaluate everything. Month two, you start exploring. Go to Peru, do some ayahuasca, buy a fun bowling shirt. And the next woman that gives you attention, you marry immediately. But boredom brings that second divorce. You start drinking, get some tattoos, and on a bender, you marry your tattoo artist. But by the time the third divorce comes, you sign the papers of the dog track and realize Scientology's got some decent ideas.
Huh.
Check sibilance, is this thing on? Hello, look at all of you wonderful people. Silky dirt dude, get to know it? Oops, sorry, I had my Jonathan Antonizer 6000 stuck in the on position. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for some entertainment landfill news. I got nothing.
Film, television, pop culture. It's where you find it.
Welcome to another exciting episode of Entertainment Landfill News.
Hi.
Well, hello there. I am the J-Strom. Welcome to the show. And I don't do the show alone. I also do it with Stephen the Pop Culture Zealot.
What's happening?
Hello, Stephen.
Hello there, Jason.
How are you doing today, sir?
Fantastic.
Hi, bitch.
Oh.
Ooh. What?
It's so nice. So rude. Well, Stephen, it finally happened. Did you like that?
Break some veins!
Now,
this was 15 years in the making.
It really was. Because if you listened to last week's episode, we did the Top Chef bit where they were talking all about bull testicles. And cow testicles, they don't have them, right? It's bulls who have them. What's funny is way back in the day, you know, with the whole thing of drops on the show, there have been times in the past where you'll mouth something to me to play. Yeah. Like, you might say, "Silky dirt." And I'll be like, "What?" And you'll mouth it like, "Silky dirt." And I'm like, I don't, wait, what? And it's so funny. There are times you'll grab a pen and you'll scribble something down. And I'm like, I can't read that. What does that say? It's illegible. So I have no idea. And you're just like, just forget it. Just forget it. So
the time has passed.
So on the last episode, during the Top Chef clip, you were like, mute the mic. Cause you, and I was like, why? You know, the clip ran out and I was like, Stephen, what do I do? And you're like, never mind. But you told me, I wanted you to play the Franks and Beats drop. And I thought about it and I go, wait a second. We've never had a Franks and Beats drop. It doesn't exist.
We've had others from Something About Mary.
Yeah, we've had the Warren, Have You Seen My Baseball? It's like this.
Have you seen my baseball?
Yeah, and we have some Matt Dillon where he's, I can't remember what he's doing, but he's basically talking about, it's one where he's talking about he used to take care of, remembered it. Do you remember this? Oh, it's so like,
I work with retards.
It's like so un-PC, but he's trying to seem real sensitive to Mary, but he says everything wrong.
Right.
We've got those, but we've never had the Franks and Beans.
Franks and Beans!
That's right.
Until now.
But what's funny is I think Steven has asked me to play Franks and Beans before, like 10 years ago. I think you did the same thing. You're like, Franks and Beans. And I'm like, what? We don't have that. But I always just imagine like, Steven, you could do like, you could just go Franks and Beans or just say it, you know, like, and then the following show, I'd be like, I'm making a drop of that. And it would be Steven saying it. Or we could even have TRS-80 saying it.
Franks and Beans.
Yeah, but it's just not as good.
Franks and Beans.
Franks and Beans. But finally, Steven, it is a drop. How excited are you?
I got a drop made.
Franks and Beans! Franks and Beans!
Now it won't come into use for another 15 years.
I love that giggle. He goes, listen, right after he says it the second time.
Break some veins! Break some veins!
He does like this little
like hiccup. Like a hiccup laugh.
Is it the Frank or the beans?
Frank some veins! But,
How the beans get above the Frank?
Very exciting. Very exciting, guys. But thank you so much for joining us on this week's episode of Entertainment Landfill News. We have all sorts of awesome entertainment news to talk about. It's very exciting stuff. But before we get to that, Stephen, we actually have quite a bit of voicemail, which is exciting. Nice. The last couple of weeks, I think we've had like one or two, but now we've got three voicemails. Yeah. And before I play those, I wanted to ask you, where were you this week?
Topeka,
Kansas. That's
still in Topeka.
That's awesome. How is it this time of year?
Hello, Frisco.
No Frisco.
Oh.
It's cold.
So you were in Kansas.
It's very cold in the morning. It gets warm in the afternoon. You don't know what it's going to be. Sucks.
So when you landed here today, were you like,
yes.
Nice weather. Nice.
Holy shit!
That's what happens when I lay in there.
Okay, so Steven, what do you say we play some voicemail?
Sure.
I'm pretty excited about this. But we got to have the voicemail intro. Am I right? Can't just go into voicemail. TRS-80, you know, I wrote the script, the MS-DOS, to have her create this intro. So we got to play it. All right, here we go, guys. Voicemail.
And now it's time to hear some voicemail.
So exciting. It's quite a build-up, Steven. So here we go. Our first voicemail. First voicemail is from Adam. Adam from the Bay Area. Let's check it out.
Hey, Jason and Steven. Nowhere in Mulberry / Entertainment Landfill crew. Hey, guys. Enjoyed last week's show. It was really cool. It was balls out. I wanted to send a quick voicemail to tell you guys that I enjoyed the use of the drops on this show. I love the intro, too. And, just pretty much more foggy in general would be great.
Nice.
I got to say, though, I was very uneasy while Jason was hoarse and asked Steven to read the Rotten Tomatoes review. I thought we were going to have another helicopter crash on our hands. So what I think is a good idea is if Steven reads a lot more stuff on the show now.
Yeah.
That way we're just going to be mining for gold drops that Foggy can use at his will. So anyways, it was nice to hear Steven read Laura Clifford's of Reeling Reviews Game Night review. Too bad she didn't like it. I loved the sounds of the lozenge. Thought I was listening to some ASMR there for a second. lots of clacky teeth noises and heavy breathing by Jason during that scene. And I really, really enjoyed
horrible.
It. But guys, I hope you have a great time on the show. Hopefully Bill can make it on the show with you guys this week. That would be awesome. I will be looking forward to listening. I won't be able to listen live. Got stuff to do. All right, guys, have a good night. Bye.
Thank you so much, Adam. And let's see if Bill's here.
He's been posting really good work of his work. Adam and Ross working together on that fence.
Yeah, I saw that. Those guys are handy,
yeah,
man. They could build us really a NIM clubhouse, couldn't they?
Nice.
Now, Adam said something interesting there about last week, you know, when I was coughing, oh, Steven, you read this review. Do you want to compare it? Let's see if it's as good as the radio crash. The radio crash. See if it's as good as the helicopter crash. You want to check it out, Steven?
Sure.
Okay, here we go.
Directors Daily, Goldstein, and a game cast. Intermittently keep this film aloft. McAdam's nutsy enthusiasm and Plemons creepy obsessiveness, particularly on target. But Mark Perez's labored script creates a drag that ultimately overtakes their effort.
What do you think, Steven?
It's just as good as my helicopter.
A rescue helicopter has crashed.
Pretty awesome. I like it, Steven.
Franks and beans!
Yes, Franks and beans. There we go.
I have to practice my... I was reading from a distance, too.
Well, let's see.
There.
What is the mom from Something About Mary think of your reading of that?
Holy shit!
All right. Well, we have another voicemail. Let's see. I've got a voicemail from Ken. Let's check out Ken's voicemail.
Hello, folks at Entertainment Landfill. This is Ken Preventure calling, just calling to leave a voicemail that I hope we'll get through in time for today's broadcast. And I know lately my voicemails have been a little long, and there's a technical glitch there where I try to edit these things
Franks
on Audacity,
and beans.
And then for some reason the edits, even though it looks like it's edited, it's not really edited. So I'll try to keep it short and unedited.
Take as long as you want.
And so it's been a while since I left a voicemail. Lots happened since then. I really enjoyed the podcast from last week. I have not yet seen The Black Panther, but I have seen Cloverfield Paradox, which I kind of enjoyed as schlock. I think that's the best way to think of Cloverfield Paradox. It's total schlock, but it's good schlock. Also premiering on Netflix this weekend, I don't know if you've heard of this, but a new movie called The Outsider, and it stars Jared Leto as this is set after World War II, and Jared Leto plays someone who's captured by the Japanese and is released, and in exchange for his release, I guess he has to help the Yakuza in post-war Japan. So it's something that's right up my alley, and it premieres on Netflix today, March 9th.
Cool.
So if you guys have a chance to check it out, I'd be interested in your thoughts. I'll be checking it out as soon as possible. I recently just saw Annihilation, which I don't think you guys talked about yet. And I'm curious what you thought about Annihilation.
We
I did
about
read
Rot
the
Tomatoes.
Book, which is part of a trilogy, the Southern Reach Trilogy. And I thought the first book, which is, I guess, what the movie is based on, was really good and very kind of creepy. I actually listened to the audiobook, and the audiobook is a very haunting experience. With the narration is done in first person by a character who has no name. None of the characters have names in the book. They're just referred to by their function, their job title. So you have four women, and one is a biologist, and one is an anthropologist, and one is a surveyor, and one's a, you know, so they, and they refer to each other by their titles, you know. So someone will say, hey, where's the biologist? Oh, I think she's with the surveyor. Oh, let's go ask the anthropologist. You know, this is the kind of dialogue in the book. The movie's very different in that there are five instead of four women, and they have names, and they try to make the lead character, the biologist, played by Natalie Portman, they try to make her kind of a likable protagonist instead of someone who in the book seemed like a borderline sociopath. She definitely had some serious difficulty kind of making friends, and I guess her marriage was falling apart, you know, and there are flashbacks that kind of talk about, like, why, you know, she didn't really love her parents and she didn't really know her husband. But in the movie, they try to make her out to be someone who is more of a normal every man or every woman kind of character. And I'm not sure that really works. It's not as horrifying to have the comfort of a likable character surviving this ordeal, whereas someone who you don't like goes through the same ordeal. You know, it adds a little extra layer of horror, I think. Anyway, I thought the movie was pretty well done, and I'm really interested in what you guys thought about it.
I would like to see it.
Alex Garland. I don't know if I'm crazy about his work, but his work is definitely high level science fiction. Speaking of movies based on books and audio books, I wanted to follow up on a post I made on Facebook about Ready Player One.
Yes.
And this is a post that I put up saying that the movie doesn't seem to be tracking to be a big success. It looks like the movie's tracking to underperform. And this is interesting. I did not expect that. I expected it to be just a slam dunk blockbuster. And I don't know what's going on. But then, you know, I did also say in my Facebook post that I thought Ready Player One was the worst book ever written. So I guess I don't know. I'm not happy that the movie is not tracking well. Because great movies can come out of really bad books. I mean, The Godfather is a good example of a really bad book becoming a really great movie. And even Spielberg does this, too. I mean, Jaws was not a bad book, I would say, but definitely the movie took that idea and from the book and made it into something great. So I don't think just because the book is really terrible that the movie has to be terrible. Maybe I should explain why I think the book is awful, and maybe that could be something, I don't know, that we talk about before the movie comes out. I don't know if you guys even want to hear this negativity, but...
No, sure.
All right, I'll try to be as positive as I can. I guess the problem with Ready Player One for me partly is how I read it, which is also through the audio book that's narrated by Will Wheaton, and I don't think the audiobook was badly done. I think Will Wheaton did a fantastic job narrating Ready Player One. The problem is, with an audiobook, it's usually the total text. So you're hearing every single word. You can't skip. You can't go faster. You basically have to take in every single word of that book. And let me tell you, that is torture. Ready Player One, word for word, is probably the worst book ever written.
Holy shit.
I'm being a little hyperbolic, but not really. Word for word, it's the worst book ever written. I think there's a great book in there that would be probably one-tenth the size of Ready Player One. And I think the real problem for me is that the character who narrates that story, and Will Wheaton, again, does a great job of this, the persona of the really hyped-up nerd who thinks everything that he likes is the most important thing in the world. And not only that, but the world around him agrees. So the world of Ready Player One says everything this kid loves is everything there is, and nothing else is important. And I don't think the book is giving us the distance from that, I would say, fanaticism that I think would make it a more interesting or better book. I think we're really supposed to be caught up in this race for power, and you get power based on nostalgia. I just thought it's not a bad idea, but it's written where it becomes the worst book ever. It becomes the worst thing ever. All that aside, the movie, I think, can, and with someone like Spielberg making it, should be much better than the book. And I'm really looking forward to it. But I'm really intrigued by the way it's not getting as much attention, maybe because it's not based on something... I don't know. It is based on something people know. Maybe it's for another generation than the generation that's tracked by this kind of advanced tracking. The title, Ready Player One, is also a problem. That phrase, I think, is of... I know what that phrase means, but nowadays you don't know what Ready Player One really means, right? I mean, you don't go to arcades and play games anymore, and you don't get that kind of... That kind of video gaming, you just don't see that anymore. There's nothing in it for today's audiences, except the older audiences. So we'll see. Anyway, I know I'm heading towards the 9-minute mark here, so I should probably wrap it up. And I'm not going to edit this, but I just want to say again how much I am enjoying the podcast and appreciate you guys. And so I will see you next time. All right, take care. Bye.
All right. Thank you, Ken. And thank you for your views on Ready Player One.
Holy shit!
Actually, with the advent of these new arcade bars, people mm-hmm. are, you know, the younger college students are going to these places and playing video games. So
yeah,
is that term maybe becoming known?
I understand what he means. And also, you know, recently we actually went to that, you know, 80s arcade.
We've been to two different ones.
Yeah.
Terry's.
Well, we took Emma and two of her friends. And yeah. One of her friends, her friend Sam, who's a boy, like the perfect age for Ready Player One. And I said, hey, are you excited for Ready Player One? And he was like, I don't know. I don't know what that is. He really didn't know about it. The thing is, that book, you could say, it's definitely a young adult book. It's for young adult readers. I'm surprised he hadn't read it, but here's the thing about Ready Player One, the book. I read it. I physically read it, you know, and then I listened to the audiobook most recently because it was on sale for like $5.99 in the Google Play Store, and I was like, oh, cool, I'm going to listen to the audiobook with Will Wheaton, because I know Bill always complained about it because he hated the way Will Wheaton would pronounce certain words like poseur, and it drove him nuts, but I listened to the audiobook, and it was funny. There was so much of it that I didn't remember. Like, I was like, you know, when he's investigating certain, like, how to get certain keys, and I was like, I really can't remember what happens here. Like, I can't remember. And then when it happened, I was like, oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah. Like, for instance, I didn't remember any of the Monty Python and the Holy Grail stuff at all when it happens in the audiobook when it got to there. I was like, I don't even remember this when I read it. Like, that's how long ago. What was that, 2011 or something?
It was a long time, yeah.
It was a long time ago. But I will say this. When I got the book, I had been anticipating it for a long time. And when it came out in 2011, I'm going to say, I read it like in a week or maybe 2 weeks. I just, you know, Bill will read a book really fast. I read it slow. I slow down. Like, I'm only going to read a chapter because I really get into it, but I don't want it to end. And we were both really into that book because it was right in my wheelhouse, you know. I was born in 1971, the 80s, especially the early 80s. I was right there, my, you know, 10, 11, 12, 13, right there.
You knew all the terminology that was going on in
yeah,
the book.
And what's thing is Ernie Cline kind of does interactive novels. Anything I didn't know, I could stop reading and look it up online. He describes some ancient cover to Zork. I can Google it and look at it and go, whoa, that's cool. Or if he talks about some video game, I could go on YouTube, look at the footage of playing the video game and know exactly what he's talking about. And it's really cool. And in fact, I loved Armada too. I do know for a fact that, especially recently, I'll get to it in the news coming up, but a lot of people hate Ready Player One. They despise it. They just remember Pixels, that Adam Sandler movie, yes. How everyone hated that. They equally hate Ready Player One. When they see the commercial, you hear that little Back to the Future kind of like that kind of Alan Silvestri thing. They get so angry when they see that. They don't like the stuff with the DeLorean. They just don't like references to other things. But that's what Ready Player One is, because you live in a world where everyone's obsessed with the 80s, because this 80s lore is what this guy put clues to in the Oasis.
Is, yeah.
Yes, where you could win billions of dollars. Now, I will say this. Years later, listening to the audiobook with Will Wheaton, there were things that I kind of winced at that's just a little too geeky, like kind of embarrassed me a little, that was just too nerdy. But I can understand. We've met Ernie Cline. We've seen him. He's a huge geek.
Yeah.
And yes, he wrote Ready Player One for himself. He's making nostalgia and the love of 80s the reason for being in this world. And it is funny when you look at it that way. There's a development in the book that I think happens way too fast now. Everything about the world of the Oasis, this VR world that you log into, in a couple of sentences, he says, and slowly I started to see that maybe life inside this wasn't that great. Maybe the outside world. And it's like, yeah, but how did you get to this? It was almost like, it felt like to me after he finished the book, like, wait, I got to say some stuff about the real world. Like, you know, VR is really bad after a while. The real world is worth living. So let me go through here and add a couple of sentences. It felt like that to me. Now, as for the movie directed by Steven Spielberg, I'm really excited about it. Everything I've seen is exciting. I know for a fact that they've changed a lot of things in the book. For instance, the whole point of the book is finding three keys to open three gates and winning the prize, which is the Easter egg, okay? And there you win the Oasis. Now, in the book, there's a part where he literally finds Halliday's lair, and he plays like an Intellivision or an Atari, and he's running around on the screen and he's playing Pitfall and stuff like that. It's like, that in a movie is not going to be too exciting. They've got to make it more exciting than that.
Right.
And I can already tell just by watching the trailer that they've upped the ante and made it more exciting. Like, maybe instead of him trying to find the egg while there's a virtual battle going on, maybe people are chasing him in reality also and they've got to get away or something. I can see they've upped the stakes. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, they were being chased in reality in the book too.
Yes, but it not in literal car chases, though.
No, no, no.
Yeah, and that's what it looks like in the... Oh, cool. Ken, you and I are the same age. That's funny. But no, Ken, I totally understand. Here's the thing. Had I just read Ready Player One and I was excited and buzzing about the book, and you were like, I hate the book, it's a horrible book, I probably would be like offended and I just wouldn't want to hear what you have to say. But it's been years and it doesn't bother me that you say that. It really doesn't. I can totally understand where you're coming from. I remember, Steve, when you read it, you were like, there's times where he way over explains stuff about games, and we talked about how that could be an editor somewhere going, well, no one's going to know what this is, you got to explain it. I can understand that too. Here's the thing about
King does that too. He over explains, yeah, he over describes,
but you know, in this he's explaining something about a cartoon in the 80s that, and if you know about it, it can get monotonous, like, yes, I know what you're talking about, can you please move on or something. But Ready Player One is a huge geeky, nerdy book for huge geeky nerds who are into that. I'm not sure it's for everybody, but I think the movie looks like it will be fun for everybody. I really do. People who don't have hangups. I think it'll be a great movie. Alan Silvestri's doing the score, and of course it has references to a lot of things. That doesn't bother me as long as it's
pertinent to the story, or whatever you want to call it.
Sit back, let the movie come to me. I'm excited about it. I just don't want to be too excited and just see what happens, you know? Will Wheaton's reading of Armada, I thought, was even better. I honestly thought he does pronounce certain words very strangely, I've noticed. And I was thinking, like, is there a guy in a booth going, yeah, can you read that word over again and say it correctly, you know, or something like that. But there's a voice he does for the mighty, great and powerful Ogden Morrow, who is the main guy's best friend. And I think Simon Pegg plays him in the movie. Will Wheaton's voice for him is so, like, monotone. I didn't think it was very good, but a lot of the other stuff he does is great. And Ken, I don't even want you to give me your opinion on Dead Ahead now, because I'm afraid you'll go, if you thought Ready Player One is bad, Jason's audiobook for Dead Ahead is horrible. No! Scene isn't
what
so,
what are you getting,
man,
back to that, by the way?
I don't know, Steven.
Holy shit!
Break some veins!
Now we have one final voicemail. And by the way, I do want to see Annihilation. I think that'll be really cool.
I saw it last week.
Oh, you did see it?
I did see it, sir.
Well?
Annihilation is my name, winning is my game.
That's what it was.
Is the Iron Enforcer in that movie?
Yes.
Oh, thank you, Ken. He said, OF, Dead Ahead was exponentially better than Ready Player One. Oh, best comment ever. Thanks, Ken. I'm even writing it, even though he can hear me. So what did you think of Annihilation?
Like you said,
Annihilation is my name, science, winning is my game.
That, whatever.
Super science-y?
Yeah. I can see where it doesn't, I enjoyed that kind of a movie, and I see it doesn't, I don't know if it would be widely accepted with everybody, you know.
You guys are really smart about this science stuff, but I know New York.
It doesn't move along at a fast pace, but that doesn't have to for me.
It's just, is it kind of like, here's what I'm hoping it is, just extremely interesting. Like,
yes.
You want to know what is going on
that's
here.
That's a great way to say it. I found it interesting.
Cool.
Kind of like, if have you seen Arrival?
I have never seen Arrival. I know it's pathetic.
I kind of put it along with Arrival, and it kind of has the same pacing.
Okay, so you highly recommend it.
I would recommend it if
it's a pseudoscience.
Okay, cool. All right. Well, what do you say we play the next voicemail?
Director's Daily Goldstein and
Steven,
a game.
The time to read a review, okay,
Come
Steven?
On, let me read a review.
All right. Our next voicemail, here's a surprise of who it is. You ready to be surprised?
Yes.
Let's check it out.
Hey, it is Rick from Australia.
Hey!
Hey!
How you going, guys? It's been a while. Sorry, I've been busy and lazy. Same old. So, you guys have been going for a hell of a long time. And I can't even remember where I was in my life when I first started listening, because it's been so long and I can't remember good, because my brain's broken. But I do remember the first time that I heard my voicemail being played on the show, and just like, you know, smiling like an idiot at work. And it was just a fun time. I was like, hey, that's me on the show.
Oh, I wish I knew what episode that was.
Yeah, I was a fan before then, and I've been a fan ever since. But just keep doing the show. Just keep doing it forever. I don't think you're allowed to stop. It's just laws of nature now. But thank you for so much entertainment over the years, and I really hope you just keep going.
Because
you do need to get on with the Chuck series companion, because that's great. I love listening to that.
Oh, that's awesome. Thank you.
It's very well done. Very, very well done. So this is Rick from Australia. Just chuck it in a quick little voicemail. Say, I love you guys, and all that positive energy. Sent you away. All right. On with the show. Kisses.
Oh, I don't want you to go yet, Rick.
I love you, Rick.
It was so nice to hear from him.
Yeah, he had posted something, and I said, we need a voicemail from you, Rick.
Nice.
Brain broken!
Oh, I'm sad to hear his brain's broken, but we miss you, Rick. That was so great to hear from you. I mean, when I heard that voicemail, when I was like, oh, that's Rick, I was literally like,
holy shit!
Yeah, I was like, wow, I can't believe it.
Oh, for God's never sake!
I'm so glad.
I miss that voice.
Yes, I do. It's great to hear from you, Rick, and also Adam and Ken. Now, what do you say we get to some news, Steven?
Yes, please.
I need a news theme. Do I have something?
You probably do.
I have the short version. Oh, here we go. This just doesn't seem right. This is Bill's news theme, right? Yeah. Yes. When I read this news story I'm about to do, I literally did say this.
Holy shit!
I really did. And I still don't understand it. I think maybe the people at Netflix are doing lines of coke or something. I don't know what's going on, Stephen.
They've made way too much money off of the things they've done so far, and they're just throwing
money out. It doesn't make any sense to me. When I think of comic book creators and quality comic book creators, the last person I think of is Rob Liefeld. Am I right?
Right.
Rob Liefeld, whatever.
Well, you love Newman.
The dude, I never trust people without, hello, Newman. God, that's such a weird reference that nobody will get. But he did a comic called Newman. But I don't trust anyone without sideburns, Steven. It's just weird. When you cut your hair where there's no sideburns, don't trust you, okay? Okay, here is what I'm talking about, everyone. I've teased it enough. Deadpool's Rob Liefeld takes his extreme universe, God, that gives me pain reading it, to Netflix in splashy deal. That's right, exclusive. Netflix has bet big on the extreme universe. I can't even read the straight face of graphic novel characters hatched by Rob Liefeld. Yes, he laid them in eggs, whose disruptive Deadpool creation was the blockbuster movie surprise of 2016, which is from when he worked at Marvel. So he does not own Deadpool, by the way. Netflix has made a seven-figure rights deal, and Akiva Goldsman will set up and oversee a high-end writer's room, similar to ones he has run for the Ology series. Wait, Akiva Goldsman? That's not good. Just ask Bill about Akiva Goldsman. and the okay, similar to the ones he's run for the I want to say Oology, but it's Ology. And the Transformers spinoffs to generate a series of feature films with connective tissue anchored by Liefeld's comic book creation. Goldsman, Liefeld, and Brooklyn Weaver will be the producer. Okay. The marriage between the Extreme Universe and Goldsman came out of an earlier deal for Liefeld's Evangeline. Oh my. Okay, first of all, I just want to say this about Rob Liefeld's creations. They're all derivative of shit from Marvel and DC. He just puts in a... I remember the comic book Preacher?
Right.
He created a comic book called Priest. That's literally how blatant he is. There's the Fantastic Four. He had a comic book called Dooms Four about four people who go into space who get powered. It's literally the same idea. He just gives them different names. There was even a rock dude that he blatantly just steals shit. Okay. Now here's the thing about
the Newmen are the X-Men.
Right. Okay. Okay, Youngblood, that's the Avengers. His team, by the way, they don't get Youngblood in this deal. All of their, maybe I'll get to that, but I'm so like, okay, I'm just so flabbergasted by this. But anyway, okay, the marriage between the Extreme Universe and Goldsman came out of an earlier deal, which he's developing Evangeline at Paramount. The new deal gives Netflix a shot at a branded series of films. The Extreme Universe covers 6 comic books encompassing more than 50 characters that include Brigade, I remember them, Bloodstrike, Cybrid, Rejects, Blood Wolf, and Kaboom. And an earlier deal had been struck involving producer Graham King and Fundamental Films, but that did not work out. And Netflix stepped up with a checkbook, Steven. The Extreme Universe characters are written very much in the subversive, edgy style that defined Deadpool. The Fox film became the highest grossing... Okay, do you see what they're doing here? Oh, he did Deadpool. That made money. Let's get his other properties. Let's get Rejects. Let's get Cybrid. Let's get Kaboom. Let's get Blood Wolf. Let's get Bloodstrike. Who has heard of any of these, Steven? Oh, my God. I mean, I can't believe this.
Only hardcore Liefeld fans.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Liefeld says that Netflix has become a part of everyday existence for me and my children. Their programming is the most dynamic and diverse I have seen. I am beyond thrilled and inspired to be bringing my extreme catalog to life with the creative wizards at Netflix. What Akiva Goldsman has achieved with his craft and storytelling across all mediums, for instance, like the Dark Tower movie, in our industry, is of absolute benefit for my extreme characters. It's so ridiculous that it's called extreme. He is an absolute comic book fanatic, and working with him on adapting the Extreme Universe has been electric. His stellar work on Star Trek Discovery has wowed the fandom, and trust me when I say that the Teen Titans show he is producing is going to blow fans away. I cannot wait to show the world what we have in store. Wow.
Holy shit!
I don't understand, Steven.
I don't remember who was it who made the comment earlier. It's like, well, they'll save a fortune in shoes.
Yeah, it was Swiley.
Swiley.
Wow. I'm speechless. I don't understand, Steven. Do you have anything to say about this, Steven?
Break some veins.
What was it? We bought one episode of Newman to tease each other with or something?
Well, I own issues of Youngblood. I own some Rob Liefeld comics. I own that issue of Captain America.
Is that the one with the weird...
He's got a giant chest.
The giant chest that makes...
I own that issue. In fact, recently, the Sam and Max thing, when you told me about that, I started going through my comic books, and I was like, holy shit, I have all these comic books that I forgot about, and I have a lot of Rob Liefeld comics. And here's the thing about Rob Liefeld. It was fuel for me when I wanted to be a comic book artist.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Because
I was like, if this shitty guy, this, he
awful
sucks.
Artist.
Can he, if he can do this, I can do it. And I, it's been like, back when I started podcasting, I would listen to shitty podcasts going, I can do better than this. Now, people, if you don't know who I'm talking about, Rob Liefeld, maybe you'll remember this.
So how long have you been drawing comic books?
Since I was about 7 years old, little kid.
What'd your parents think about it?
They hated it. They hated it. Oh, yeah. After I got a job and they saw that you can make a living out of third, you'll hear no complaints anymore.
And you created X-Force?
Mm-hmm.
So what is the drawing of?
This is the Spike Man.
And what's this right here?
This is the camera on top of your head that will record the wrongdoings of others.
So Rob, have you had any formal art training?
No. Just a lot of imagination, I think. Wait till so I say it and then look down. Or just open it and say it.
Fly button.
So that was Rob Liefeld on a 501, Levi's 501 commercial with Spike Lee. Do you remember that?
I don't remember that.
I do. That was crazy. Oh, my God. Here's the thing. He's, everything he does is so derivative. I just don't get it. But anyway, hey, good for you, Rob. I can't wait to watch the Blood Wolf series or Rejects or what was the other one called?
I don't remember.
Brigade. I remember that was kind of like there was Youngblood was the Avengers. Brigade was kind of like the West Coast Avengers kind of a thing. Okay, now I want to talk about Ready Player One again. Here's the story. Ready Player One, at least Warner Brothers, put out an oh shit, I messed my news story up. Okay, here we go. I got it back. They released some movie posters. They did a Ready Player One, Blade Runner. They did a Labyrinth. They did Bullet. They did The Matrix. Did you see any of those?
No.
And people went ape shit. They were like, oh my God, what is this?
I read your little thing about it and people were freaking out.
Yeah. This is from Yahoo. And the article is, wow, people really hate the new Ready Player One posters. And I was reading it, people's comments on Twitter, and I was like, wow, I can't believe the hatred of this. I don't get it. Ready Player One, directed by Steven Spielberg from the Ernest Cline novel, is opening in theaters March 29th, which is 20 days from now, Steven. A lot of people already don't like it for varying reasons, some based on the book, some not. It seems cool to not like it, or at least to not like the new posters. That became clear to anyone checking out Twitter on Tuesday after the new posters started making the rounds. You can check out all the posters at Slash Film. They pay homage to nostalgia movies like Back to the Future, The Iron Giant, Rambo, The Breakfast Club, The Lost Boys, Beetlejuice, Blade Runner, The Goonies, Risky Business, and more. Ready Player One digital characters are inserted in the posters, as you can see from the examples. Some fans and Slash Film, among other outlets, like the posters, but the movie title got itself trending on Tuesday because of all the non-fans roasting the hell out of it. One person said, "These Ready Player One posters are a form of assault. I'm pressing charges." Another person said, "This pretty much sums up this whole Ready Player One poster situation." And that's not a good example. One guy named Bob commented, "We deserve to die as a species. We are so weak. People getting this upset over posters about a movie that banks heavily on nostalgia. Wait for it. It uses nostalgic posters." Another guy says, "Have these people ever read the book? The entire story is about taking things from the past. The people complaining about these posters are going to be the same ones who complain that the movie doesn't follow the book line for line. The movie is going to be..." He broke up his sentence there. "Wow, people really hate posters. Let me then proceed to produce only two tweets from random nobodies. Like, I care what two random people think." Exactly, Steven. I don't know who any of these people are, nor do I care. But like I said before, I'm excited for Ready Player One. What did you think of the posters? I think they don't look good. I think that when you make a decision like that, like a studio, like, hey, let's put these out. I wonder if the person doing it is like, a lot of people are going to hate these. Do you remember when the Ready Player One trailer...
Were they just kind of like mock-ups, too? They weren't fully realized
it was
posters.
It was just a thing to release to people to see. It almost gives you an idea, like, For instance, one of the posters said something interesting, and I wondered if it was a clue to the movie and stuff they've changed. Let me see if I can find the post where I talked about it. And let me see what it was. Oh, it was the Rambo one. It says, he was on a mission. Run three races, win three keys, unlock a better reality. And I was like, wait, run three races? Does that mean the races are going to be, instead of hunting the, looking for the keys, they're going to do races in the game, in the movie?
All speed racer.
Yeah, and I started thinking about that, like, that's, yeah, like Speed Racer or something. And I was like, that's weird. Maybe that explains why they do the bullet poster, you know, the Steve McQueen movie. But I know, you know, in the original Bullet, but in this one, you see that it's the DeLorean. So I don't know. I don't know. I'm excited about the movie. I don't know what they're going to do, but that's a little clue there. The reason they're showing these is because the whole point, if you haven't read the book, the idea is the world, everybody lives in this massively multiplayer online RPG VR world. So instead of me looking like Jason, my character might look like Batman, and yours might look like Aquaman. And that's how we look to the world.
No Aquaman.
You wouldn't be Aquaman.
No.
But, you know, it might be something like that.
Holy shit!
Yeah, I know. It's exciting. So I can't wait to see the movie.
You're Aquaman. There's no water here. What are you doing?
You're just walking, I guess.
No. Director's Daily Goldstein.
Steven, no. Not yet. Okay, so here's my next story. Wonder Woman 2 will feature Kristen Wiig as the villain Cheetah. How cool is that? Saturday Night Live alum Kristen Wiig will play the role of Cheetah in Warner Brothers. Wait, I just said that. As one of Wonder Woman's oldest foes, Cheetah has almost as many incarnations and retoolings as the heroine herself. In her original incarnation, crafted by Wonder Woman creator William Moulton Marston, she had no superpowers, just a burning jealousy of Wonder Woman and a spotted cat costume. But in her modern incarnation, Cheetah has been molded into something of a funhouse mirror of Wonder Woman's drive and origins. She is also a woman who is endowed with godly power. But where Diana derives her power from gods who she loves and respects, Cheetah sought the power for more selfish reasons. And her godly patrons are anything but reciprocal to her devotion. Whoa.
Holy shit!
Yeah, I know. Barbara Ann Minerva is an archaeologist who has dedicated her life to seeking out the divine in what most people consider to be legends. In the most recent retelling of Wonder Woman's origin, Minerva was greatly motivated by meeting and working with Diana. The revelation that Themyscira and the Amazons were truly real drove her to seek out other evidence of ancient gods. Eventually, she found it in the form of the fictional god Urzkartaga, who transformed her body and endowed her with powers, great strength, razor claws and teeth, a predator's hunting sense, and superhuman speed at a heavy price, uncontrollable bloodlust and cannibalistic urges. Awesome! Unable to escape Urzkartaga's blessing, Cheetah often twists her own self-loathing and shame into a hatred of Wonder Woman, blaming her for igniting her quest for the divine and for not saving her from herself. In the hands of a good writer, she's like some of the most compelling and famous Batman villains, dangerous and tragic in equal measure. Kristen Wiig might not be the first name you'd think of to play such a character, but she hasn't flinched away from the dramatic, with parts in Mother and The Martian. A Wonder Woman sequel would be her first role in a major superhero movie, unless you count Ghostbusters, in which we don't. Yep. Patty Jenkins is confirmed to return as director for Wonder Woman 2. I don't know why you threw that in there. We already knew that, so shut up. Right, Steven?
Yeah.
Holy shit!
Okay, sorry. Okay, here's some other exciting news, Steven. Iron Man's Jon Favreau will write the upcoming Star Wars live-action series. What? This is for Disney's forthcoming streaming service. Iron Man and Iron Man 2 director Jon Favreau has been tapped to write and produce an upcoming live-action Star Wars show. Didn't I just read that, Steven?
Sounds like deja vu to me.
Deja vu all over again?
Yes.
In November, Disney announced two projects, a new trilogy of films written by The Last Jedi director Rian Johnson, which everyone's happy about, and a live-action show for the company's upcoming streaming service, which is expected to launch sometime next year. Disney also announced last month that Game of Thrones showrunners Dave Benioff and D.B. Weiss are developing their own series of films. And I don't know if you knew this, Steven, but those are the guys who did Game of Thrones. Yeah, you did know that, because I just said that. In addition to a Star Wars show, Disney has also said that the streaming service will have other original content from its various holdings, including a live-action Marvel show. What? That's exciting.
Holy shit!
I know.
Marky Post got some mouth on her.
Favreau is no stranger to Disney. He directed the live-action version of The Jungle Book in 2016 and is presently filming a live-action version of The Lion King, which is slated to be released in 2019. By the way, I thought The Jungle Book was solid. I enjoyed it. I thought it was good. Favreau has been involved with the Star Wars franchise as a voice actor, voicing Pre Vizsla in the Clone Wars animated series, and he was great in that, as that voice. I liked the Pre Vizsla. He was like this Mandalorian, like, you know, Boba Fett armor, but he's a real dick. But he was pretty cool. It was pretty cool that he was a villain, you know. And he also plays an alien in Solo, a Star Wars story. Lucasfilm president Kathleen Kennedy says, "This series will allow John the chance to work with a diverse group of writers and directors and give Lucasfilm the opportunity to build a robust talent base. My first hire will be Jason and Steven." Oh my God. What? Oh, I'm so excited. The company did not announce any further details about Favreau's series nor release date because they haven't created anything yet. A live-action show set in the Star Wars universe has been a long time simmering for Lucasfilm. You better get that off the stove, Steven.
No, I like it to simmer for a while.
Oh, okay. While the company has set up two enormously successful animated shows, The Clone Wars and Star Wars Rebels, which just finished its run, Steven, and I need to catch up on it, but I'm going to get emotional, man. George Lucas said in 2005 that he was working... Oh, 2005, you're going back that far? That's the first year of our show. That's a long time ago! Anyway, that's enough of the story. What do you think about that, Jon Favreau doing that?
Sure, I like Jon Favreau.
Oh, for God's never sake!
Yeah, I think that too.
I mean, he did the first Iron Man.
How excited were you when you first heard it, though?
What, did you shit yourself or something?
Okay.
Well, that's when I read the article about the fish guy.
The fish guy? Oh, I know. You're talking about that article that I posted about the Doug Jones had to poop before getting into his fishman costume for The Shape of Water. Yeah, that was a little much. Did you see, I said, I can picture this writer fretting over a looming deadline. Jeez, the chief says I need to step it up. I haven't delivered anything clickbaity and ridiculous lately. I've just got nothing. But there was this Doug Jones interview where he said he was stuck in a fishman costume for 16 to 17 hours a day. Wait, I know! And then the headline is, Doug Jones had to poop before getting into his fishman costume for The Shape of Water. It's just so ridiculous. You could say that about anyone who wears a costume for a movie, you know? Zachary Levi, he's playing Shazam right now. I guarantee it's not easy to go to the bathroom in that thing, you know? Stupid story. Okay, Steven, finally, our final story. A teaser trailer for Disney's Christopher Robin starring Ewan McGregor. Oh. That's right. Disney has unveiled the teaser trailer for their new take on Winnie the Pooh, titled simply Christopher Robin. From director Mark Forrester, Ewan McGregor stars in this as a working-class family man in London. He re-encounters his childhood friend Pooh, who helps him to rediscover the joys of life. The main character cast includes Hayley Atwell. Come on, nice. You know, that's Peggy Carter. Yes. Mark Gatiss. wait, isn't that, that's a guy from Sherlock, right? Adrian Scarborough, Roger Ashton Griffiths, Paul Chahiti for the voices. Jim Cummings as Winnie the Pooh. Oh, when you hear that Pooh voice, your heart will melt, Stephen. Chris O'Dowd as Tigger. Toby Jones as Owl. Pete Capaldi as Rabbit. Sophie Okonedo as Kanga. And Nick Mohammed as Piglet. This teaser only introduces us to Pooh, with more characters to come. This comparison is going to upset a few of you, but this kind of reminds me of Hook. A grumpy guy revisits his past to rediscover happiness again. Yeah, whatever. It's nothing like Hook. All right, let's check it out, Steven.
We've called an emergency meeting this weekend. I promised my wife and daughter I'd take them away this weekend, sir.
We need to cut 20%.
You were promised these people good jobs.
And I thought you'd do anything for this company.
Well, have a good time.
From the studio that brought you Beauty and the Beast comes a new adventure.
What to do, what to do, what to do. To do indeed. Pooh? Christopher Robin. I've cracked. Oh, I don't see any cracks. A few wrinkles, maybe.
Aww, it's Winnie the Pooh, Steven. That looks so cute. Come on, did your heart melt at that, Steven?
Winnie the Pooh.
You love Winnie the Pooh?
I had a Pooh bear.
Aw, Steven, I bet that got you right in the heart. Did that pull on your heartstrings?
A bit.
Holy shit!
Exactly.
Make some veins!
Okay, enough of that. Okay, Steven, what do you say we get into... Oh, wait. Actually, no. We have something new. Let's check it out. A new thing on the show, Steven. Uh-oh. We're unveiling right now before Rotten Tomatoes. Here it is.
It's time for Playing Games with Steven the Pop Culture Zealot. The game where we check to see if Steven's microphone is working or if he's even still awake. Let's challenge him to some zany stuff. So what do you say, everybody? Let's challenge Steven to some trivia and other crazy shit.
Yes, crazy shit. Oh, the music isn't ending yet, Steven. Alright, I'm excited! Woo! Could probably add some applause in this part. Yay! Alright, Steven. I had this idea that we should play a game every week on the show.
Okay.
For Rotten Tomatoes. Now, here's the thing. I haven't really come up with anything. I need people, listeners, to contribute. Come up with games for me to give Steven, basically. So if you guys want to suggest games, do it on our Nowhere Mulberry fan club, Entertainment Landfill fan club. Jesus. Also, you could send me ideas for games on nimpodcast@gmail.com. You could even create a game for me to do this. Now, my first game involves sound drops, Steven. And it's going to be pretty interesting. I don't know how this will go. Say, for instance, like last week, do you remember the Top Chef thing? We did it. They talked all about testicles. Now, I would do something like, say, in our drop folder, type in the word testicles. And you would have to guess without looking. Steven, how many drops do we have in our drop folder with the word testicles? You would just throw a guess there.
I'm going to...
Just throw it out there.
12.
Okay, that's a pretty good guess. We don't have that many. We have 5, which is shocking. Now, if you were to say balls, how many?
I kind of was going with that, thinking balls, testicles, same thing.
Can you think of even one testicles drop, like through the history of the show, one you've heard? Don't say Franks and Beans, Steven. Like, do you remember this?
Only if I can rub your testicles.
No.
Let's do that again. You said 12, right?
Yes.
See, I wrote testicles. I should have written testicle because now there's 8. Okay. So you know at least one of these. Come on, think of it. We always play it whenever Bill does a story about testicles or balls or something like that. This always plays.
One of my testicles has enlarged.
Eric Estrada.
Yes. Okay. What is this?
Testicles, brains, intestines.
Okay.
You lose a testicle.
All right, Steven. Now let's check out balls. I want you to. How many drops with balls do you think we have? Just throw it out.
7.
There. We have 34.
I'm gonna send you home with your balls in a sling. You got that?
Wow. Wow. There's a lot of balls drops.
Holy balls.
Yep. There's a lot.
I am tough as balls.
Don't go busting my balls, Billy, okay?
What's this? Wait, what? I don't even recognize this one. Let's see this one.
Hairy balls.
I know what these
hairy
are.
Balls.
These?
They're called hairy balls.
Oh, stop it.
Hairy balls. Hairy balls.
Man, my balls are shaved. My pubes are trimmed. I'm ready to fucking rock this shit.
Only I want his balls.
Oh, my God.
I love your balls.
Wow, there's a lot of balls dropped, Steven. A lot. It's ridiculous.
A little obsessed with the balls. Here.
Cock, balls.
You're scanning my balls?
Holy balls.
All right, let's come up with another one. How about, how many son of a bitch drops do you think we have?
16.
Wow, that was really close. We have 15. That was pretty good. Now, I'm going to try to play one that you remember. Okay, this is good. Can you identify this drop?
Son of a bitch.
Play it again.
Okay, you want to hear that again?
Son of a bitch.
I'm not getting it, no.
That's Dean Cain on Smallville. Now, you'll definitely get this one. I think you will.
Son of a bitch!
That's pretty...
One more.
Son of a bitch!
No.
Sawyer from Lost. I'm trying to think of any of these other ones. What about...
Son of a bitch!
That's pretty easy.
That's just Costanza?
That's John Stewart.
Oh. Son of a bitch!
Son of a bitch, you!
You son of a bitch!
That's when you recognize that one? No. Okay, here. Okay, now I'm going to go real nuts, Steven. Okay, here we go. How many Colonel Ty from Battlestar Galactica drops do we have?
Oh, 23.
11. But we have...
You son of a bitch!
But my favorite Colonel tie drops were this. Do you remember this? And, of course...
Shut your fucking mouth!
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, if I were to type in... Oh, okay. Let me think... How many drops do we have with the word dick?
I would say probably well over 50.
A dick move.
We have 54. Hey, you're getting... That's pretty good, Steven.
Come up in here, piss on my dick, tell me it's raining.
Oh, my God.
Yes, it's true. This man has no dick.
I got a little dick. It's pathetic.
You're a dick.
Wow, that's...
Paul's a... Alright, he was a... in season 9 and he's still a...
You can't even hear it in that one.
Yes! Yes! Yes!
But also, that was evil dick. That doesn't count. Oh. It's labeled dick. Do you remember the one where it's just...
Dick.
Yes, there we go. This game isn't really good, Steven, because I'm
no good at remembering all the little drops.
Yeah, like...
I would totally lose against Adam, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah. Well, Adam's the king of the drops. I'm trying to think of a good one to go with. Okay. No, I just thought of one. How many drops do we have with the word sausage?
Oh, 28.
Yeah, the sausage.
We have six.
We have the one.
Yes.
A f***ing sausage.
Yes, I love sausages. Well, Steven, this was our first edition of Play Games with Steven. And as I said, guys, you have ideas of games that I can play with Steven. Send them to me. And this is going to be a new segment on the show. What do you think, Steven?
I mean, I wish it wasn't such a sausage fest.
Yeah, me too. But still.
Well, I'm in.
Still, it's good times.
Holy shit! Shh.
Now, Steven, what do you say we get into, what is it called? Do you remember what it is we do, Steven?
Something rotten.
Oh, I remember what it is. Is it Let's Read Rotten Tomatoes?
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
You say either, I say either. You say neither, and I say neither. Either, either, and either, neither. Let's call the whole thing off. Yes, you like potato, and I like potato. You like tomato, I like tomato. Potato, potato, tomato, tomato. Let's call the whole thing off.
Smell like spilled tomato juice.
Ah, yes, it does. All right, Steven, let's read Rotten Tomatoes.
Director's Daily Goldstein.
No.
I already read that.
You're jumping ahead. Let's check out some reviews. Last week, do you remember what I read last week? Oh, you know what? I wanted to go back on Peter Rabbit. Did you see that Peter Rabbit article I posted where people were mad?
Yes.
It was 60% fresh, 49 candidate fresh, 33 rotten. I thought it looked horrible, mainly because that James Corden is in it. Yeah. Ugh. Rebecca Mead of The New Yorker said, "The movie remains an object lesson in how to not adapt a beloved volume to the screen." Susan, oh no, this lady's name always gets me. Woloshina of RogerEbert.com. Easy chuckles are no substitute for genuine charm. I'm just glad that Corden didn't insist on doing Rabbit Burrow karaoke. I get it because he does the car karaoke thing. 2 out of 4. Adam Graham says, "There are good laughs along the way, but they're clobbered to death by Gluck's insistence that you acknowledge them C+. C+ is a passing grade, isn't it? Why is that green?
I don't know.
Katie Walsh of Tribune News Service says, "The gentle spirit of Beatrix Potter's books is subsumed into a chaotic, violent mayhem, maniacally soundtracked to the day's hits." Oh, that sounds terrible. Linda Cook says, "Peter Rabbit is shrill and surprisingly violent from the atmosphere of the beloved Beatrix Potter books." Now, I want to go back and find that story because it was funny. Adam from the Bay Area said, "Hey, I took my daughter to go see Peter Rabbit, and it was pretty good." And I went, "I heard it sucked." And it's bad, Steven, because these rabbits assault the guy in it, okay? Sony apologizes, Steven. I'm back to reading news stories. Let me let this story load. Sony apologizes after Peter Rabbit movie exploits a food allergy, upsetting parents. Can you believe this shit? Tom McGregor, a villain who has food allergies, goes into anaphylactic shock when rabbits fire a blackberry into his mouth. Some parents said it sets a poor example. Now, they have a good point. Little kids are very subjective. Like, you could show them something like making fun of a person with an allergy. It's not really funny. It's deadly. Like, for instance, in school, there's kids who sit in the allergy section, the no peanuts.
There are?
Yeah.
I had no clue.
They have the peanut table at schools because people can die from eating peanuts. You know, their throats close up and they can't breathe and they die. And you have to have a EpiPen.
They didn't have that when I was in school.
Yeah, you know, that's why so many kids died when you were in school, Stephen.
Right. I'm surprised there were many of us that graduated.
Yeah, you know, not many survived.
Holy shit!
Yeah, I know, but...
like five in my class, we all lived.
But this is a movie for kids, and they had a part where those rabbits, these asshole rabbits, are firing blackberries into a guy who's allergic, and it's supposed to be funny. He
hilarious.
Even, they said in the movie, he even can't breathe. He's grabbing his throat and he has to run and get an EpiPen and stab it into his leg just in time before he dies. And little kids are like, let's do that to Billy. He's allergic. Bad, bad, Steven.
Don't peanuts in his throat.
Now, Steven, did you see the commercial to a movie called Hurricane Heist?
I have seen this.
It doesn't look good. It's starring Maggie Grace, Toby Kebbell, Ryan Quanten. That's Jason from True Blood. I love True Blood. That guy, he's so good in that show.
I might be paraphrasing a little.
Paraphrasing. I love that. Now, Hurricane Heist is 29% rotten. 14 reviews counted, 4 fresh, 10 rotten. Wow, not many people watched this, did they? Okay, let's read the plot of this movie. Under the threat of a hurricane, opportunistic criminals infiltrate a U.S. mint facility to steal $600 million for the ultimate heist. When the hurricane blows up into a lethal Category 5 storm and their well-made plans go awry, they find themselves needing a vault code known only by one Treasury agent, Maggie Grace, a need that turns murderous. But the Treasury agent has picked up an unlikely ally.
Mixed metals. Yes.
A meteorologist played by Toby Kebbell. Terrified of hurricanes but determined to save his estranged brother kidnapped by thieves, he uses his knowledge of storms as a weapon to win. This sounds ridiculous! His knowledge of storms? And this thriller ride charged with adrenaline, directed by Rob Cohen, who I believe did Fast and the Furious. Now, wow. Let's read our first review of this movie.
Directors Davey Goldstein and a game cast. Intermittently keep this film aloft. McAdam's nutsy enthusiasm and Clemens' creepy obsessiveness, particularly on target, but Mark Prez's labored script creates a drag that ultimately overtakes their effort.
good stuff, Steven. I really like that.
Holy shit!
All right, Steven. Michael Gingold of Time Out says, this one's just blowing through theaters on its way to streaming services.
Not even.
He's pretty proud of himself, yeah, isn't he? Yeah. Andrew Barker of Variety says, if our divided country can't come together over a movie this wonderfully terrible, what hope do we really have? Wow, it's deep. Alonzo Duraldi of The Rap says, a laughable caper wherein the good guys continually manage to thwart the bad guys through skillful manipulation of a Category 5 hurricane. Peter Sobzinski of RogerEbert.com says, one of the dumbest variations of the weather-based action thriller subgenre that I have ever seen. 1 out of 4. I just remembered that Christian Slater movie. What is that? Hard rain, where they're robbing the bank or they're stealing gold or something during a hurricane. No, not a hurricane. It's a flood.
It's a flood, yeah.
The whole town is flooded and Morgan Freeman's in it. Randy Quaid is in it. Oh my God. This sounds like that movie, doesn't it?
Pretty close.
I didn't know there's a action thriller subgenre that was weather based. Did you?
What, you got shit in your ears? Come on.
Oh, sorry. But you know what? There aren't all bad reviews, Steven. Like I said, 14 people watched this. 4 people liked it. One of those 4 people is Courtney Howard of Fresh Fiction. She says, Rob Cohen's riotous actioner spectacularly delivers on the promise of satisfying popcorn movie moments. Hey, she just sold me. Nick Shaker of The Daily Beast says, like Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, The Hurricane Heist is 2 great cinematic tastes that taste great together. Rob Cohen's films ably lives up to its preposterous premise. Chris Bumbray of Joe Blow says, if the words hurricane and heist translate into words must and see, then this movie is for you. 7 out of 10.
7 out of 10. We got to see it now.
Steven, back in the day when you and I would go to Blockbuster after work on a Friday, we would have rented Hurricane Heist, wouldn't we?
Oh, we definitely would have.
Hurricane Heist.
I mean, the only thing it's missing is Alfonso Ribeiro.
Yes.
And
okay.
Clint Howard.
Fred Topel of Monsters and Critics says, we need movies where bad guys try to rob the treasury in the middle of a hurricane as much as we need somber treatises on the state of the world. Wow.
Where's the cricket noises?
Roger Moore of Movie Nation says, an utter excrement storm from start to finish with zero laughs, intentional or unintentional to boot. 1 out of 4. I'm retiring. I'm no longer reviewing movies. Oh, my God. Why would
I've lost my faith in humanity.
I know. I want to see that. Now, I keep seeing advertisements for this movie called Gringo, as starring Charlize Theron, David Oyelowo, Joel Edgerton. It's got Amanda Seyfried in it, Charlton Copley, Tandy Newton. It's directed by Nash Edgerton. I have no idea what this movie's about, but let's check it out. Combining dark comedy with dramatic intrigue, Gringo joyrides across the border into Mexico, where all is not as it seems for mild-mannered American businessman played by David Oyelowo. Crossing the line from citizen to criminal, Harold tangles with duplicitous business partners, Mexican drug lords, international mercenaries, and the DEA. As he attempts to survive in one of the most dangerous places on Earth, the question lingers, is this ordinary man in way over his head, or is he two steps ahead? Currently, this is 36% rotten. 27 fresh.
Yeah, I saw the trailer for it. It looked like two people, Charlize Theron and her...
Joel Edgerton.
Created a drug recipe, and they were sending it with this guy down to Mexico, and he gets kidnapped.
Well, James Barrera Dinelli, Stephen, he didn't like it. I left the theater vaguely annoyed, as if the filmmakers had thrown away some promising ideas and elements in weaving together a thoroughly generic chase movie and pretending it's something special by employing ineffective stylistic choices. But let's see what Richard Roper thought of it, Steven.
He probably liked it.
Director Nash Edgerton and screen... Wait, is that Joel Edgerton's brother?
Yes.
Director Nash Edgerton and screenwriters... Who was that who just said that? Anthony Tambakis and Matthew Stone do a fine job of juggling the multiple storylines, moving things along at an entertaining clip. I give it 3 out of 4. I do not pass go, but I do collect $200 in your face. Oh, okay. He doesn't have to be a jerk about it, does he? I mean, wow.
Maybe he does.
What, did you shit yourself or something?
All right. Now, finally, A Wrinkle in Time came out, Steven. Have you ever read the book?
No.
Did you read it when you were a kid?
Uh-uh.
That is... currently 42% rotten. Fresh 67, 93 rotten. Meg Murray is a typical middle school student struggling with issues of self-worth who is desperate to fit in. As the daughter of two world-renowned physicists, she is intelligent and uniquely gifted, as is Meg's younger brother, Charles. But she has yet to realize it for herself. Making matters worse is the baffling disappearance of Mr. Murray, which torments Meg and has left her mother heartbroken. Charles Wallace introduces Meg and her fellow classmate Calvin to three celestial guides, Mrs. Witch, Mrs. What's-It, and Mrs. Who have journeyed to Earth to help search for their father. And together they set off on their formidable quest, traveling via a wrinkling of time and space known as Tessering. They are soon transported to worlds beyond their imagination, where they must confront a powerful evil. To make it back home, Meg must look deep within herself and embrace her flaws to harness the strength necessary to defeat the darkness closing in on them. All right, this has Oprah Winfrey, Reese Witherspoon, Mindy Kaling, Zach Galifianakis, Chris Pine, and a bunch of little kids. All right, well, let's see. Joshua Rothkopf. He liked it. He said, no Hollywood film can ever solve the central problem of adapting this book, and that it inevitably does too much of the imagining for you. DuVernay makes a big-hearted go of it. Even if she seems slightly dazzled by her own magical mystery to her, I give it a 3 out of 5. All right, what a nerd. David Ehrlich of IndieWire says, perhaps this movie is so striking because it's such a wonky and self-possessed experience. Too much of its own thing to feel like it was tailor-made for anyone, but the people who need it most. C+. Didn't we see a C+ earlier count as rotten?
Yes.
I'm always so confused. Bruce Damara of the Toronto Star says, the plotting is a bit clunky at times, but it doesn't detract from the emotional resonance that shines throughout. I give this a 3 out of 4.
Rotten.
No, it's a fresh.
Oh, they got it right.
Sandy Angulo Chen says, inclusive but imperfect take on a classic story of hope and love. 3 out of 5. Frederick and Marianne, it took 2 people to write this, Stephen. A science fiction fantasy about a girl's quest to discover her own power by embracing her faults and expressing her love. 3.5 out of 5. Now, Luke Hierfield of We Got This Covered says, A Wrinkle in Time comes off as a disjointed and miscalculated project rather than a visual and contemplative journey. I give it a 5 out of 10. Adam Graham says, A Wrinkle in Time is a rather unruly mess, and when you untangle it, all you wind up with is a ball of nothing. I'm so proud of myself, C-.
Well.
Now, Stephen.
Directors David Goldstein and a Game Cat.
Come on, you already read this. Stephen, don't know if I want to see that, but I do know this. Strangers Pray at Night has come out. Did you see the original Strangers? Where the creepy people with masks?
No.
With Liv Tyler? You never saw that?
Uh-uh.
Well, sequel's come out, Steven, so get extra excited. It is 37% rotten, 17 fresh, 29 rotten. It stars Bailey Madison, Emma Bellamy, Martin Henderson, Lewis Pullman. Come on, aren't you excited?
Every one of those are golden actors.
And Christina Hendricks is in it from Mad Men. Clark Collis of Entertainment Weekly says, 2 films in, The Strangers has already become a horribly familiar franchise. I give it a C+, which equals rotten. Are you confused?
Yes.
Mark guy named Mark from RogerEbert.com says, an unexpected anomaly sequel that both is better than and fixes the problems of its predecessor. I give it a 3.5 out of 4. I think it's weird, the 1 to 4 scale. Like, when you do 1 through 5, you have more stars to deal with. You could make things 3 stars, 2.5 stars, but you do 4? I don't know. Bruce DeMar of the Toronto Star says, it would have helped immensely to have actors who could make us care about the awful things happening, but one really can't blame any of them. I give it a 4 out of 4.
These young next generation actors.
A 2 out of 4, I'm sorry.
See, that's still me passing.
That's
it
half
has
of...
to be, yeah, it's half. I mean, it's not quite failing, it's not quite passing.
Well, guess what, Steven? Brian Orndorff of Blu-ray.com loved it. The newest celebration of nihilism and chart-topping hits from the 1980s is actually quite effective when it wants to be, finding signs of life in a brand name that was on its way to the morgue. Well, Steven...
Maybe you need a lozenge.
What do we got? No lozenges. Next week we have Tomb Raider coming out. Are we going to go see it?
Sure.
Tomb Raider? Yeah, looks good. And I think Heather wants to be on the show. Should we set up a headset for her next week?
No.
No. But you know what else we got after that? Okay, so next week we have Tomb Raider. Then, let's see. Then it's the 23rd. We have Pacific Rim Uprising. Did you catch that in the intro, Steven? War ready. War. Do you remember that from the trailer? War ready. War ready. I'm excited. I think it looks good. What's funny is Stephen DeKnight, who directs it, he's the guy who did Spartacus, Blood and Sand. Uh-huh. He did the first season of Daredevil. This is his first film directing. He's directed TV shows before, but I'm really excited about this. He talked all about when they lost Charlie Hunnam, because Charlie Hunnam was getting to do his dream project, and it was going to happen the same time as Pacific Rim, so they couldn't use the script they'd written. So they wrote a new script involving Idris Elba's character's son, and they were like, who can we get to play his son? And people were like, how about John Boyega? He was just in Star Wars. And they'd heard, like, he didn't really want to do other sci-fi stuff since he was part of this huge sci-fi franchise now, right?
Right.
So they had him come in for their product, you know, show him different projects they had to see if he was interested. But Stephen DeKnight was, I want this room to be nothing but Pacific Rim stuff. I want storyboards. I want the models. I want all the stuff. We're going to bring them in here, okay? And we're basically going to go, oh, yeah, this is Pacific Rim. We're starting to work on this movie. And so he walks in, and he's like, oh, my God, I love Pacific Rim. And he's like, I love the monsters, the robots and stuff. And they're like, well, it's funny you should say that, because we have a part for a guy that looks just like you. And he was like, I want to do it. And he, like, signed up. So they, like, they lured him in there, and they got him to sign up for the movie. But I'm excited, Steve.
He did the sci-fi Attack the Block.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I have no idea what that song is, but I think it's funny.
Holy shit!
I know. Steven.
Break them veins!
Yes! Well, guys, that was Let's Read Rotten Tomatoes. Thank you so much for listening to this wonderful episode. But I will be right back. We'll see you on the flip side. Okay, Steven?
Yes.
All right.
Thank you. Good night.
Steven, a man of many words.
What, did you shit yourself or something?
Oh, Steven.
Yes.
You're okay?
No, I did not. I'm good.
Okay.
Break some veins!
All right, guys. Thank you so much for listening to this edition of Entertainment Landfill News. This is episode 51, by the way, Steven. It's been so awesome doing this show with you, just talking about dumb news stories, reading Rotten Tomatoes, and now we're going to start playing games with you. It's going to be awesome. We're going to start playing mind games, man. I'm just going to freak you out.
I'm going to lose. Big time.
Guys, if you would, visit us at etlandfill.com. There you can find all of our previous episodes. You can check on the right under links and find our show archive. There you can find every episode of our show, including episode 103. That's right. I don't know why I said that. Just a random episode. You can find episode 4. You can find episode 92. Episode 204. What about episode 16?
189
is there too, Steven. You can find all of those. You can find our lunchtime shows. You can find our NIM movie minis. You can find our NIM commentaries.
That sounds like a good game. Guess what episodes we can find, Steven?
I know. Yes, we're going to do that next one. We once did a commentary of movies. We did a commentary of all the prequels, Bill and I. We also did Lethal Weapon 3, if you guys ever want to hear that. Just, we done some crazy shit. Recently, I kind of highlighted some of our NIM movie minis we did, where we talked. Steven, do you remember that you and I did a Jaws episode? Do you remember that?
Yes.
That was a while back. It wasn't that long ago, but...
We didn't do that stupid movie I was part of, did we?
No.
We talked about doing one.
No, we didn't. We need to just watch it while we can hear it and talk about it. But we've done NIM movie minis of Goonies, Die Hard, RoboCop, Gremlins, Lethal Weapon, Back to the Future, Jaws. Oh, man. Bill and I even did practice runs. We did X-Men First Class and Super 8, kind of when I was trying to figure out the format. But... I love those episodes. And if you guys want to go back and check those out, just click on the link that says Nim Movie Mini. You can hear us talk about those movies. It's very awesome. Guys, thank you so much for listening. Also, if you want, you could become a patron. Go to patreon.com/landfill for as little as a dollar a month. You can support the show and at times get free goodies. Sometimes get shows early. Yes, get me some lozenges. Have you noticed my throat has been fine this week? I've been good.
You've been talking more this week, or cough medicine or something?
I just think I'm better, yeah. Also, check out our Entertainment Landfill Fan Club. That's right, guys. The Entertainment Landfill Fan Club is basically taking place of our forum when we had one, where you can make funny posts and stuff, and we'll comment on things. It's awesome. Well, Steven, you got anything else you want to tell me?
Directors David Goldstein.
Steven, come on. We already heard your review of Game Night. Good stuff.
Holy shit.
I know, right?
Listen, it's not the end of the world. These kind of things happen.
Yeah, I know. Steven, thank you so much.
I've actually had three big D's slap me right across the face.
Excuse me? What is
it? No, Scientology's got some decent ideas.
Guys, thank you so much for listening to the show. How many times have I said that?
Oh, four or five.
Steven, you need to thank people now.
Everyone, thank you for listening to the show.
Yes.
Is it DeFranco to Beans?
Which is your favorite part, Steven?
Is it DeFranco to Beans?
Yes, I love the Frank.
Break some veins!
All right, everybody, that's our show. What are you waiting for? Get out there and watch some Pacific Rim, and we'll see you next time.
War ready.
Yeah, war ready. I don't even know what that means. All right, guys. Check you later.
That's it. The show is over. Leave. Peace out.
Casting.
Break some veins! Break some veins!